Let's dive into Lab's Fast Remesh to see how this tool is built. And Fast Remesh is a five-step process, with the first step being partitioning of our geometry based on the specified options. So we have some UV separation here, connectivity separation here, and some clustering that happens later. The second step pertains to the target type that was selected. So we do some calculations of surface area and how many polygons we might want if we divide the surface area into equilateral triangles, how many polygons that would leave us with, really taking advantage of the fact that remeshing leaves us with triangulated meshes. We'll touch a little bit on that math later. Third step is our remeshing operation. And this is looping over all of our partitioned pieces and made even faster with the use of compile blocks and multi-threading. The fourth step is an optional step, but a step I leave on by default, and that is seam remeshing. So when you remesh separate pieces, the seams can sometimes look out of place. You can see where the different partitions were, or in the case of adaptive remeshing, the resolution of the seams does not fit with the resolution of the mesh. In the case of adaptive remeshing, there is some sophisticated seam resolution going on here because the other methods are much more straightforward to remesh, but the case of adaptive resolution leaves us with a few artifacts that we have to resolve, and we'll also look into that. And finally, the last step is some post-processing settings. So now let's look at each one of these steps in more detail. To quickly illustrate what's happening in partitions, I have some spheres copied to points and that are auto-UV unwrapped. When only 3D connectivity is enabled, we see that all the spheres are different colors because it's only based on connectivity. But if we zoom into the UV seams and we enable UV connectivity, we see we have clean cuts where the UV islands were, and enabling bucket size further divides those UV cut islands or parts of the geometry into clustered polygons. So let's dive into Fast Remesh here and see what's going on. So we bring in our geometry here, and partition's unique identifier is called work item name, or FRM work item name for Fast Remesh. Step by step, here we have the UV cuts. If we choose to go that route, then it's fed down into separating out by connectivity. And they're on switches, so we can have one and not the other. And then afterwards, we do some clustering here, where we take each piece that we've already separated out in the previous steps, and we scatter some points over the piece, and we do an attribute transfer to do a radius lookup and transfer additional partitioning identifiers to the polygons around it for processing later in the remesh stage. Let's talk about the five different remesh target types. Our first option is target edge length, and this is the most straightforward option as it directly sets the target size we are going for in our remesh parameter. We also have ratio of average input edge length, and we calculate the average edge length of the input geometry, and we modify that amount by a scalar value. And this is useful if you are processing multiple meshes with similar resolutions. Target output poly count. We use our knowledge of remeshing and the fact that it attempts to create equilateral triangles to our advantage. So we calculate the surface area of our input geometry, and we divide that by the number of polygons. This gives us the ideal area of one equilateral triangle, and from the area of one triangle, we can find the desired edge length for remeshing. And ratio of input poly count follows these same calculations, but instead of explicitly setting the number of target polygons we're aiming for, we find the number of polygons from our input geometry, and we modify this by a scalar value. For adaptive remeshing, we calculate the curvature of our input geometry using a measure sop, and we remap those values using our min and max edge length values. And the measure sop gives us this attribute that we can use later on. Here in adaptive remeshing, we look down here. We also have our curvature attribute, and this is being fed in to adjust the edge lengths of our mesh. So now that our mesh is partitioned and we have our target edge length calculated from whatever remesh target type we have chosen, we can start the remeshing process where we iterate over each partitioned piece in this for each loop. And whether or not we're doing adaptive remeshing where we use our curvature attribute from earlier, or a typical remeshing where it is fed in our target size, it performs the remeshing process. And while we're already in here and we have this piece separated out, we group the edge points and primitives together to later on check for overlaps or to perform the remeshing seam operation. And all of this is nested in a compile block. And when you enable multi-threading on your for each loop while in a compile block, it will perform these operations in parallel and distribute it to different cores. So it's even faster than a typical partitioned remesh. The next step in our process is to remesh seams of partitioned pieces after they've been fused back together. And we do this because if we zoom in here, we see that we have some fairly straight lines that are an artifact of clustering polygons. And they might not be so evident in a mesh like this, but they can be super evident in meshes that started from lower poly meshes. And to remesh these seams, we just remesh this set of polygons here along this edge. And it makes it look much more cohesive with the rest of the mesh, and that it fits and flows much better. And this is especially important if we have adaptive remeshing enabled, because without this, we are left with holes in our mesh, and I have these displayed with these 3D island boundary visualization. Here we are in our network addressing this hole, and everything encapsulated in this purple network box is solely for the purpose of addressing the seam resolution in adaptive remeshing. So what this process does is it identifies points like these and these that are not connected to a neighbor primitive, and it finds these neighbor primitives. Like here, it finds this primitive, and it finds this primitive, and it associates it with the proper point. I'm just going to focus on this top one right here. So once we find this point, we find this primitive. That means we take advantage of the fact that this is a triangle, and we can find this primitive's three points. And our goal is to split this primitive from this end to that end. So we take, again, advantage of the fact that it's a triangle, and we see that these two points here and here are collinear with this third point. They all lie in a straight line. So we don't need those two points. We want to use the point that's non-collinear. So these are out, and we want to use this point, and in theory, divide along this line. But what we're actually doing is we're creating two new primitives, and we're deleting the old single primitive. And we've got these two new ones, and we fuse them all together. And then there's some math to ensure that the new vertices that are created have the proper UVs on them, and everything's transferred accordingly. And it loops over as many times as it needs to address all the holes. And in the end, we get those stitched up. And for everything other than adaptive remeshing, like target edge length, remeshing is quite simple, as we identify these polygons along the seams, and we run them through their own remeshing process. Afterwards, it's fairly simple post-processing, such as fusing any more rogue points together, calculating normals. If you don't want them calculated, you can turn that off. Sometimes the original normals that come in look better than the normals that are computed afterwards, along with credit to the initial creator of the tool.